Welcome everyone to our webinar presenting the CFO survey results. Twice a year, we engage over 1,100 CFOs across Europe, gathering their perspective on a number of topics that are shaping the finance agenda. This report delves deep into their nuanced thoughts, encompassing everything from risk assessment, inflation management, to strategic planning. By leveraging the data and perspective gathered from CFOs, we aim to provide a clear picture and the unique challenges and opportunities CFOs may face. This edition is centralized around three themes: the economic outlook, digitalization, and of course, sustainability. Let me first start with some perspective on economic outlook. The last couple of years, we saw large uncertainty in the boardroom. We had COVID, a return of inflation, increase in interest rates. Interesting, as an outcome of our current survey, we see an increased sense of optimism among CFOs about the economic landscape, with a shift in focus from cost reduction to value creation. The optimism is more pronounced within the construction industry and within non-listed firms. However, supply chain is still a challenge. Before we go into more detail, I would like to introduce my two guests, two seasoned CFOs, Marjanne and Rianne. I would like to start with our guest, Marjanne. Maybe a short introduction from your side.
Yes, sure. Thanks, Mohamed. Now, my name is Marjanne van Ittersum. I'm CFO for Ingka Centres. And Ingka Centres is actually part of the Ingka Group, who is actually the largest franchisee of IKEA brand. So in Ingka, we have three lines of business. One is the familiar IKEA stores we have in various countries. The second part is Ingka Investments. That is to ensure the financial stability and the financial long-term perspective of the company. They are investing in, amongst others, forests, but also wind energy, etc. And the third line of business is Ingka Centres, where I'm the CFO of. And Ingka Centres is actually the shopping center, or as we call them, meeting place business. We currently operate 35 meeting places around the world, primarily in China and in Europe, but also to a lesser extent in the North Americas.
Sounds like a CFO who sits in the middle of the economic outlook, dealing with optimism, but also I think with some uncertainty so now and then.
Yeah, I guess so, yeah.
Definitely,
yeah.
We'll cover that. Maybe, Rianne, you have been here before, of course, in our studio as the Deloitte CFO, but maybe still a short introduction from your side.
Yes, thank you, Mohamed. My name is Rianne Jans, CFO of Deloitte. Happy to be here. You know, I've been with Deloitte for the last 4 years. Very interested to hear your story, Marianne. And from a Deloitte perspective, indeed, very interested to share the survey results, because we still see exactly what you see as well. We see the challenges in the energy prices as well, next to the inflation, next to the consumer spend as well, whereby we still see a full pipeline. But for example, the decision making is definitely delayed. So that's what we see on the economic outlook.
Thank you, Rianne. Maybe let's dive into the first topic, right? The economic outlook. There's a lot of optimism, and at the same time, we see an uncertainty around the geopolitical developments around the globe. Supply chain is still an attention point. Maybe within your role, how do you deal with that? On one hand, you see optimism and there's still a bit of uncertainty in the world, and I think you have strategic plans. How do you address that as a CFO?
So actually, we have always been, and we are, in both angles. So we're both in the value creation part, but also in the efficiency part. Value creation we mainly achieve via, let's say, our new developments. And there we really look carefully in where do we want to invest and where do we want to divest. But also the value creation also comes to life in, let's say, our new formats that we are developing. For example, we have developed a co-worker, sorry, a customer, let's say, meeting a customer, place where they can actually work. But we also introduced our new food plant-based concept, Salohal, so it's more food-based. And thirdly, we are always in sustainability investments. So that's the one part, the value creation part. But the other part is also clearly we still have a focus on doing things in a simple way, in a cost-conscious way. I think that you always need to do that. So we balance a little bit both of them, always. Yeah.
And what CFOs tell us, right, also in our service, also, I mean, to find a balance between short-term and long-term perspective,
yeah.
Right? And
yeah.
How is it within your organization?
Yeah, we are mainly, since meeting places, shopping centers are always for the longer term. You don't do an investment and it materializes tomorrow. Yes, we look at economic stability. But you can also see that when you start a project now, we will probably finish in 5 to 8 years later, and then the situation can have changed significantly. Yeah.
Thank you for that. I will come back later to see how you prepare for the future, right, from
yeah.
a finance perspective.
Sure. Yeah.
Maybe, Rianne, I think one of the outcomes was the still uncertainty around supply chain. In the dialogue and in the conversation with our clients, what is their main issue around and concerns around supply chain?
So what we see is that supply chain is still uncertain, and a lot of companies do make analysis where to source. So China sourcing only is always a very, you will be dependent on what they can source there. So we see that sourcing is broadened, but not changed totally. So if you look at scenarios, a lot of companies make scenarios where to source alternatively. And South America is being mentioned, for example, but to really change the supply chain from Asia to South America, that investment is too big. And we don't see that happening.
So you see more scenario planning also from a supply chain perspective.
Yes.
I think that's also a trend that that got kicked in, I think, also in our previous survey. So it's definitely a trend that we see. If we embrace this scenario thinking, right, I think also from a strategic planning perspective, I think also within your organization, you are preparing for different type of scenarios. Could you elaborate a bit on that?
Yeah, as Rianne already said, indeed, we are also doing a lot of scenario planning, especially on the geopolitical risks, I would say. So we look into already before we start somewhere, what can happen actually? And then we look into, let's say, more reasonable, logical scenarios, but also more towards the extremes. And then we actually look at what we want to, let's say, minimize the maximum loss that we can make. So we do quite some scenario planning upfront before we start somewhere. Yeah.
Can you share some lessons learned of preparing a scenario?
Yeah, I think one of the, let's say, the big lessons I have learned is that you should not limit yourself. So as an example, what happened in Russia, I mean, we did do some scenario planning for Russia, but of course, we did prepare for this scenario, but we all said, well, it's probably not so likely. And then we also felt that sometimes it's even a little bit complicated to get, you know, real serious thoughts about this part. So that is my biggest learning, actually, that don't do scenario planning too narrow. Really assume for the worst as well. Yeah.
I can also imagine, right, that if you have, it feels also a bit of a preparation and a bit of a dry run, right? That I think at the moment the event occurs, that you at least have some handbooks that you can, you know,
exactly.
Bring to the table.
Yeah.
And of course, reality is always different, but there's a little bit of preparation, then it's not going to be a full surprise.
Yeah. Yeah, because in that way, at least you have a kind of starting point. Huh?
Yeah.
And then, of course, every situation is different. So indeed, you always need to adjust what you are actually doing. But at least you have a starting point. Yeah, fully right. Yeah.
if we bring that to Deloitte, Rianne, in terms of scenario planning, and then maybe also from cost conscious to more value creation, any experience that you would like to share with our audience there?
Yeah, so Marjanne, what you describe, that's what we see as well. We see the scenario planning really helps to prepare for the possible outcomes, what might happen in the future. And I think in the end, we become more agile. So management becomes more agile to make decisions faster if something does occur. Yeah. And what we also see is that we have identified the drivers which are very important for that change. And if we define the KPIs, as cascading that down in the organization, everyone is on the same page. Everyone knows what does good look like in such an event. And that's what we definitely learned, to make those drivers visible for everyone. We can drive the change together.
Yeah.
Maybe to close this topic, economic outlook, what is, let's say, the topic on top of your agenda from an economic outlook perspective that keeps you busy?
Yeah, I think that the what is on the top of my agenda is basically the planning on where to invest and where to divest. So where do we actually want to be present, and where would we prefer to be a little bit less present? So that is on the top of my mind. And that has a very close relationship, of course, with the economic outlook, because it is including the geopolitical risks that you run. But on the top of my mind, indeed, is let's say this diversification on where to invest and where to divest. Yeah.
Maybe that's also a bridge to the next topic, one of our themes within the survey, right? That's digitalization and AI. I think we definitely see a trend that AI is more adapted by CFOs. So I don't think it's a hype anymore, but let's validate in the coming 5 to 10 minutes. At the same time, investments in AI are still modest, right? One of the biggest challenge for CFOs is to define use cases. I mean, they see a lot of in the media, a lot of around campaigns, etc. You see a lot of AI in moving definitions, etc. But bring it really close to home to the CFO agenda. CFOs are really looking forward to it, right? Because I think for a number of reasons, one of them is that their talent is really asking for more usage of AI and digitalization. Maybe to start with you, Rianne, how far are we as Deloitte with usage of AI in our CFO team?
So I would definitely recognize what you're saying here. So even in Deloitte, we're at the forefront of AI. Using AI in our finance organization is something we're starting with. We have, you know, full digitization plans. I also call that AI. And what I see is that our people really love to work with the latest and greatest. So all we can connect, also from an international perspective, providing transparency, making decision making easier, is something we embrace. I think it emphasizes the added value finance can bring. The recurring tasks go down. So with that, our work is becoming, you know, very much more attractive. And as a finance business partner, we increase our added value there. So I think in the tools we use as well, we see that the ERP systems, the ServiceNow, we see that AI is embedded there. So there we also see that we can bring that easier to the finance function. If I look at the broader organization as we are in Deloitte, for example, in the audit side of our organization, they have already embedded AI into all what they're doing. So to the clients, you know, we audit, we really put that into the way we work. So that's, you know, I would say definitely a big step up.
So it's definitely no hype anymore.
No.
And Marjanne, I think for sure you also have done, I think, your first pilots and use case. What are the first experiences that you would like to share with us?
Yeah, so we are, I must say, AI-wise, we are a little bit at the beginning, at least from the centers part. So we do use it in certain areas. For example, in our visitation counting systems, we have implemented in several meeting places in Europe accounting system, which is, let's say, acknowledging GDPR, of course, but there we use AI to actually count the customers. So we are doing some AI, let's say, solutions, AI-based solutions. However, we can also scale up much further. Huh? For example, our sister company, IKEA, they can also easily use it for, let's say, whole room decoration design with the IKEA furniture. So there's, I mean, you can imagine numerous opportunities. Now the next step is actually to implement them, because as the survey also showed, the investments are still limited. Yep. And that's what I also see. Yeah.
At the same time, we see with small firms and with new entrances, right? I think they are a bit further in investment. You might say they don't have a legacy, right?
Yeah.
At the same time, I think the bigger firms and corporates are still struggling with data quality.
Yeah.
A lot of them are still saying, hey, we need to fix our data quality foundational before we can go to the next step. I'm not sure if I agree with that. I think this is a great momentum to utilize AI to improve and to enrich your data.
Yeah.
Any thoughts from your side, Rianne, on this?
Well,
because we need to fix the data quality, right? Because we can't.
Yes, and as long as I've been in finance, we need to fix data quality, I'll be honest. So, you know, this is a long story to go, and we've traveled along that road as well. And data quality is a lot, right? Data quality is data ownership, you know, who is really the data owner of certain elements into systems, you know, and it goes beyond finance. It's HR data, it's your client data. It, you know, if you really want to use AI well, all your data quality has to be at the same level throughout your organization. So not only as I'm the CFO in the Netherlands, but all across the different entities in the world. And that's still sometimes a challenge. And if I go even beyond that, if we now go to non-financial reporting, it's really interesting. What can we do there? If we talk about ESG data, you know, data quality is also very, very important there.
Maybe let's go to the center, see what's happening there from a data quality perspective.
So I fully agree with you, Rianne. We are also still struggling a bit with the data quality. I guess you're right. It will never be enough. That is why for AI and also for digitalization, we focus a lot on leadership. Because in the end, we believe that this is a big change. It's a big adaptive change. So it's not black or white. So we focus a lot on how to deal with AI in the future and what are the possibilities and how do you actually implement it. Data quality is more the foundation. I also think that indeed we will come to that in the next topic on sustainability.
Absolutely.
But it has a big correlation. But for AI specifically, we focus a lot on leadership.
And if I might ask, Marjanne, what is your leadership message to your team around this topic?
Yeah, I think the leadership message is right now, explore, and think about what kind of solutions AI can bring. And then the next step actually is also to embed them in a structured way. Yeah. But right now, the main message is explore and think about what possibilities can we actually achieve with AI?
I think you're spot on there. I think it goes beyond compliance. And very often, that is still a bit away from a financial perspective. We want to ensure compliance on the data quality side.
Yeah, 100% completeness and accuracy.
Exactly. And if you go to the AI side, you know, we might want to work with a certain bandwidth.
Maybe a question to both of you, right? Let's say in a world without limitations, but in a world with AI, what would be, let's say, the first domain within your finance team or agenda that you would like to cover or to improve or to bring to the next level with AI?
For me, I guess it would be twofold. On one hand, I mean, I think that we still spend a lot of time on, you know, getting data right. We have a lot of discussions on should it be this number or maybe it's that number. So I really would like that we skip that part, huh? And then we can immediately talk about content.
Yeah.
On the other hand, I also think it's more the repetitive tasks we have. Yeah.
Yeah. And before I go to Rianne, I really recognize that, right? When we have conversations with CFOs and their teams, they want to be the business partner, right?
Yeah.
And they still spend a lot of time in getting the data right and the reports and yes, then share the insight, but not having, let's say, the time and the room to really discuss and help the organization with, let's say, in which direction you should move. So I think that's definitely something that we should tackle as CFO professionals. And then in the ideal world from your side, Rianne, how would that look like?
Yeah, and I recognize what you're saying. So the reporting, we can still gain so much time and spend that time on really in-depth analysis.
Yeah.
You know, what does it mean? The what if question.
Yeah.
And bring that value to the business stakeholder.
Yeah.
I think that would be my ideal scenario. So to really engage in multiple ways within the business from the perspectives we can share and create that added value in the end. If you go to the boring element of finance, the recurring element, so to say, I think that's also something which is very valuable. We can automate that. It's low hanging fruit. Just do it. Yeah.
So let's come back to this in our next webinar to see what we have done with this ambition. I'm keen to hear, let's say, your experiences. Maybe to close this topic, but I'm for sure it will come back also. We're going to address sustainability. I think sustainability has been on the agenda, I think, for a couple of years and becomes more prominent also for CFOs and their teams. I mean, looking to the results, to our survey results, we see that the majority of CFOs see sustainability efforts as a really value-driven theme rather than a compliance-driven. I think where it was 2 to 3 years ago, it was mainly seen as a compliance. So I think that's a really nice shift. However, there's different type of approaches, depends on which industry you are looking to. And then companies express still a feeling of unpreparedness for upcoming sustainability regulations. I think there's a lot of focus on CSRD deadlines, right? Which is maybe to an extent still a compliance exercise, but everyone is really looking to the more strategic value that CFOs and companies can deliver. And CFOs really experience, but also the teams that they now can play a really crucial role. Maybe to start with you, Marjanne, are you there now? Is it still a compliance exercise or you moved, let's say, out that box and becoming a more strategic partner?
I think for me, it's both ends. Huh? So it's still compliance because we have to adhere to the new ESG reporting guidelines. And we are still a little bit exploring on what does that mean? So we know now more or less what we need to report globally, but then there's also different requirements for each and every of the countries, which might be even higher than the European ones. So that is what we are exploring on the compliance side. At the same time, we believe that, and we really have set quite ambitious goals for sustainability. So we, for example, we just finished with including sustainability in our investment requests so completely. So we will not only look at the financials, but we will also look at what does it do for our sustainability goals.
Could you give an example of that exercise?
Yes. So, for example, when we do a new investment in a certain meeting place, mm-hmm. then we will basically have a narrative on why this is a good investment. And then there will be, let's say, financials on is the investment, the internal rate of return, is that okay? But we will at the same time also look at how does it look like sustainability-wise. So how big is the investment we need in sustainability in order to still achieve our goal that we have set? Because sometimes we also acquire, let's say, we call it brownfield, but existing centers. Mm-hmm. and they actually have a climate footprint already. Some are newly built. Most of them, unfortunately, are built in the 70s or 80s or 90s. And then you also need a certain amount in order to ensure that you will still make your goals. So that is what we have incorporated now fully in let's say, the investment request. And that is more the financial part. Mm-hmm. Huh? Then I think that what we are mostly working on right now is, as we call it, sustainability by all. Because right now we are organized...
Sustainability by all.
By all.
Oh, I love that one.
Yeah, because right now we are organized, we have a separate sustainability department, but we all agree that in the end it should be sustainability by all. So it is just embedded in, let's say, each and every function we have. Everybody should not only think about, oh, what happens with the financials, but also what happens with our sustainability goals. Yeah.
And maybe you could leverage on maybe on one example where you can say, hey, by this exercise, we really display and demonstrate the added value also to the business.
Yeah.
From a sustainability perspective.
Now, for example, then I talk about our new formats. We have just introduced a new format in San Francisco called Saluhal, which is, let's say, the Scandinavian food, let's say, concept. Mm-hmm. So it has a cooking school, but it also has, you can buy their, let's say, burgers, because we adjusted a bit to the American taste. But it's all fully plant-based. So in that way, we try to combine that it's a profitable business, but also to combine the sustainability part in it. So, and we have more concepts. So we have also, we call it circuit, which is like a circular concept where you can bring your secondhand clothes, but also furniture and what have you towards. That is a little bit more complicated to get that profitable as well, because this Saluhal is clearly will be profitable.
Yeah.
Once we are out of the introduction phase. So we try really to embed in our new formats the sustainability part as well.
I think a really great example of a really integrated approach. And as I said, I really love the sustainability by all. I might copy that.
I didn't invent it myself.
I'll copy it from you then. Rianne, if we bring it to Deloitte, sustainability, where are we?
Yeah, so Deloitte is a different organization, of course. And what you see on the sustainability agenda, in the end, every company can contribute, but every company can have a different impact in the end, because the footprint is already different from the start.
Of course. Yeah.
And if you look at Deloitte from our operations, we have a different organization. So we have a lot of colleagues who are working for Deloitte. And what we have embedded in the organization is that our CO2 footprint has been lowered, for example, by demanding that everyone is going to drive in an electric car.
Yeah.
Or, go by train, for example.
Yeah.
We've really stimulated that. So everyone also has the possibility to use an app and even look at your CO2 footprint with the consumption in your home. And if you also look at your own setting, I mean, that's where we can, in the end, if you say by all, I think in the end, if we all include all our colleagues, then we can really make the difference. And if you look at the way we work, we have we are at the edge of reporting on CSRD. So by the end of this month, we close the books. So the CSRD reporting is within Deloitte now embedded for the first time. So it's a big change, double materiality. All the non-financial reporting we have to have in place. So it's a big step up. We used to have already, for example, our loans, embedded with sustainability indicators, influencing the interest we pay. But now it's really fully embedded in the scope 1, 2, and 3. Yeah. So that's, I would say, a nice step up.
And maybe also, I think that's really a nice story, right? And I think a great example, right? How to address that. But I think what also CFOs are telling me, I mean, behind the scenes, it's always challenging, right? Within the board, with your stakeholders. What has been, let's say, the number one challenge for us as Deloitte and then within your role as CFO?
The number one challenge is, honestly speaking, that non-financials are challenging in itself. So we have always been reporting on it, but with the CSRD demands, it goes a step further. And as you know, we don't have a nice ERP system to report on the non-financials. And it goes beyond what we're used to supply. For example, if we look at office spaces, how can you report on that? Not knowing, for example, if you're in a rental office, not knowing what kind of energy supply is there.
Yeah.
And that's the level of detail you need to have. So I think we went further into the grapevines to find really what makes the change. What kind of energy do we source in the different offices we have throughout the country?
Yeah.
As an example.
And your sustainability report is for the Netherlands only, or is it worldwide?
So we have different levels, to be honest. So we have one which is across certain, within Europe, so
yeah.
to say. We also have one for the Netherlands as part of our annual integrated report.
Yeah.
We also have worldwide reports on sustainability,
yeah.
As we are a global firm.
And maybe, Marjanne, to ask a question around non-financial data. I mean,
yeah.
yes, right, the financial data, we have stored that, we have processed that in ERP systems and in data warehouse, et cetera.
Yeah.
I think we as finance professionals have been facing, or let's say, the challenge how to deal and how to report
yeah.
on non-financial data. How yeah. is that within the center?
We are not as far as you are, Rianne, yet, because we have we are a non-listed company, so we have a little bit longer. But I think that the data quality is an issue, as we mentioned before. And secondly, indeed, how to actually gather all the data. And then that's why I was asking as well, because we, Ingka as a group, is a very global company. So we need data from all kinds of areas around the world. And that is a challenge by itself. So we have set a growth path, and we will, get the assurance over certain elements this year and the other ones in the coming years. Yeah. Yeah. Just because before Ingka, I used to work for the Dutch Railway Company,
yeah.
and there we also had limited assurance on certain non-financial data. And there the big challenge was indeed the data quality and the systems where we derived the data from. That was the big challenge, to show the reliability of the data.
Maybe two questions to both of you, right? If we... one, walk away from this assurance part and the reporting part, but try to give it a bit more purpose, let's say, the sustainability from a
yeah.
finance perspective. What do you tell to your teams?
Yeah.
If I can start with you.
I think to my teams, I don't have to say too much, because they are of a generation that really believe that sustainability is key. Eh? So they fully understand.
Even demand it, maybe.
Yeah. So they demand even more sometimes. And then it also depends a little bit on the local requirements. Eh? Basically what I'm telling them is yes, we on one hand we will adhere to the total group reporting. On the other hand, we also need to see ourselves what is on top of that is relevant information.
So you even need to temporize a bit instead of, let's say, encouraging and
yeah.
pushing.
Yeah.
And I think on top of that, what's going to be, let's say, the... I think we're going to have our CSRD, right? Depends on,
yeah.
on the timing. But what is beyond the CSRD? What's going to be the key thing to do?
I think that we should step away from sustainability being a kind of compliance, regulatory item. Instead, I think that we really all have to feel, and I can luckily see that around me a lot, that it's really so important. So we should basically stop the window dressing on the greenwashing. But I think that's why I'm also so fond of this sustainability by all. I think everybody has to live sustainability.
Absolutely.
Yeah. That's what I see as well.
Yeah.
I think it the purpose behind why we're doing this within the whole of Europe, in the end, drives, you know, the finance function as well to do so.
Yeah.
And what strikes me is that if we have a vacancy on the CSRD reporting team, for example, that one is fulfilled really quickly.
Yeah, I can imagine.
That people like it, and even people who do not know everything about it love to learn it.
Yeah.
So there's a natural eagerness to do well here. And I hope that is, how you say, that is going to impact everyone within the organization, but also to our clients, because that's my, so to say, bigger aim, that we can, in Deloitte, we also don't need to do it now. We're not listed, but we like to be at the forefront.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
And having that knowledge in the organization and sharing that also with clients is something what really drives a lot of people.
And Rianne, what is our plan beyond CCD? What's then the next step?
The next step is indeed to make society better. To make all the companies, make all the governments, even at governance, you know, we also have to realize that fundamental changes need to take place there. So buildings and everything what you're mentioning, it is a bigger task to make the right choices there. And all across, you know, not only in the Netherlands, I think we cannot do it alone, and we need to do it within Europe, but even, you know, on a global scale as well.
And maybe then to close this topic, right? It's some CFOs, I think they have tackled it, right? But I think they said, sometimes it feels a lonely journey, right? But I think it's really important that it's going to be a shoulder to shoulder with CEO, with the rest of the board. Yeah. What is your experience in that?
No, I fully agree. I'm in a lucky circumstances that I don't have that I'm lonely. On the contrary, I would also almost say. So let's say this is, let's say, an important topic from the CEO to the coworker we have. So I'm kind of lucky that I'm not alone in this. Definitely not. No.
Yeah, so we mentioned earlier, short-term and long-term investments. And I think if we relate that to the climate, we all know that we need to do it.
Yeah,
And that's what we all feel throughout the organization. And I feel also very much supported within our organization to discuss this and to make the right choices to change that, to make the right investments, because it's not an investment case which is all positive.
No.
You know, we need to invest with each and every one of us. And that's something what we need to do on the short term, but also on the longer term.
Yeah.
And that perspective, I think the CFO can really provide the transparency and drive the change. Be the one driving that throughout the whole organizations, in the operations, the finance function becomes more relevant with that.
Yeah.
Absolutely, right? It feels like we are on track, definitely, if you compare it with 2 years ago, right? I think we are doing the right things, right? And we are becoming more and more the business partner, and it's not a lowly job anymore. I think we also are able to also to present also the business value, not only, let's say, the compliance part. So I think, and then maybe later on, if AI is going to evolve a bit into the right direction, I think we also can tackle the data challenges, which are still there. Looking, let's say, also to scope 3 and what more we need to do in the coming years. Maybe lastly, if we're going to fast forward, let's say 12 months, right? I think there's a lot of optimism in the market. And economic curves go up and down. AI is becoming more mature. Digitalization is on its way. We still have a sustainability challenge. There's still, in some cases, labor shortages also within finance. At the same time, we see more investments going into AI. Maybe some short reflection on finance talent usage of AI in the coming 12 months.
Yeah, I think we are again a bit lucky. We don't have that big of an issue. I know that the IKEA stores have big issues, but we in centers are relatively okay. But still, I think that you have to invest in sustainability and in AI, also to attract, let's say, the younger generation, because they, what I see is that they really want to work for companies with a purpose. So in that way, I mean, we have a clear purpose, so that's good for us. I think that young ones don't want to work for companies that don't invest in AI or in sustainability. So you have to simply to attract talent as well.
Oh, absolutely, I think that's also our experience.
Yeah, I can fully copy that.
Yeah,
I can fully copy that purpose is very important. Learning is very important, innovation, so AI, innovation, digitization. The younger generation is very eager to develop.
Yeah.
And I believe that is also what makes, for example, Deloitte also very attractive.
Yeah, for sure.
From especially when you come from university, the learning curve is extremely steep in an environment we can provide.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Maybe to summarize our webinar, right? We started with the economic outlook. Still a lot of uncertainty there, but from a Dutch perspective, there's still a bit of optimism. And I think what I've learned is also the importance of scenario planning, right?
Yeah.
I mean, prepare for the future.
Yeah.
You never know what you're gonna face, but on one hand, prepare for it. AI is not a trend anymore. I think it becomes more and more mature. It needs maybe more investment and I think also more talent that can embrace it and bring it to the next level. I think from a sustainability perspective, we have been able to load also the purpose part, and where we see the collaboration becomes more stronger also on a board level, but also within organizations. And I think maybe to close with, because I really love it, is sustainability by all. Let me first thank you both, Marjanne and Rianne, and also thank you the audience, and see you next time. Bye-bye.